Watch out, everybody. There's a guy here in Festus, Missouri that believes the King James Bible, and he's not afraid to tell everybody. He's not ashamed of it. He's not a cult leader. He's not in a cult. He's not an idol worshiper. He is a Word of God believer, because I believe the Bible was sent down from heaven. This is Pastor Mike, and I'm online, and I am live with you today. Ezekiel 33, I've got this in my mind. If you read my tweet, which also turns out to be a posting on Facebook, I worked it out that way so that everybody can catch on to it, even the non-Facebook people. You guys sent me a question about this Jesus calling goo, and that's what it is, and we're going to talk about that today. And I wasn't sure what I was going to be doing today, and I woke up this morning like at stinking 4 o'clock in the morning and was just going through some old notes, and I thought, you know what, I'm going to do this today. And we're going to visit some old teachings that I've done in the past and kind of glue it together with this Jesus calling goo that's out there. But here's what impresses me about many of you folks that listen to this broadcast, listen to the Watchmen broadcast and things like that, is that God has given you a similar calling to what he's given me. You may not be able to look into a camera, stare into it, and talk to it. Some people, that's just very unnerving to them. They go, me, it's nothing. Hey, how is everybody doing? Okay? It's always funny when people come visit the church that, Pastor Mike, can I take your picture? And no, I'm really camera shy. And they go, oh, you're kidding. Yeah, I'm just kidding. You may not have the character about you. You may not have the personality about you. To be able to talk in front of people, to be able to go online and do live broadcasting, or sit down with some notes and do a Watchman broadcast or whatever. You may not have that. That's okay. You're still watching. You are eyes and ears on the wall, and Ezekiel 33 is our passage. Again, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, speak to the children of thy people, and say unto them, when I bring the sword, not if, when, it's going to happen, everybody. When I bring the sword upon a land, if the people of the land take a man of their coast and set him for their watchman, if when he seeth the sword come upon the land, he blow the trumpet and warn the people. By the way, you might want to make a note of this. In Ezekiel 14, God talked about his four sore judgments, and one of them was the sword, the four. Get it? Anyway, it's the fourth kingdom. Anyway, warn the people. Then whosoever heareth the sound of the trumpet and taketh not warning, if the sword come and take him away, his blood shall be upon his head, his own head. He heard the sound of the trumpet, the scriptures. That's what that trumpet is. John heard a voice, as the voice of a trumpet behind him. He turned, it was Christ, the word of God. God told him in Numbers, make two silver trumpets. The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified seven times. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them, thou shalt preserve us from this day forward. No, that's not what the King James says. Thou shalt preserve them from this day forever. But if the watchman, verse 6, see the sword come and blow not the trumpet, and the people be not warned, if the sword come and take any person from among them, he is taken away in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at the watchman's hand. So thou, O son of man, I have set thee a watchman unto the house of Israel. Therefore thou shalt hear the word at my mouth and warn them from me. God had said in Amos, surely the Lord will do nothing, but he giveth his secret to his servants, the prophets. God is going to reveal what he's doing, why he's doing it. And I believe scripturally that God can, even within the bounds of scripture, I believe God can notify by Scripture, by the word of the Lord, when he's going to do certain things. And so my encouragement to all of you out there listening, all of you watchmen, keep watching, keep looking, keep sending it to me, keep bombarding me with emails and Facebook messages and letters and packets in the mail with little clippings in it. Keep doing that. I may not respond. There's no way in the world I could respond to everything. But keep sending the information. And as long as you don't care who gets the credit, God will be glorified. And I had a guy one time that was emailing me, and he got mad because I couldn't respond to everything he was sending me. He wanted me to write him a report on everything that he sent me, and I couldn't do it. And he got mad that I never mentioned his name or said thank you on anything that, and I'm going, that's it right there. He wants the credit. As long as you don't care who gets the credit for it, and I won't take the credit for it, I give the glory to God. God laid this, and I don't even remember who it was, but in Thursday's broadcast, somebody brought up, have you ever heard of the Jesus Calling book? It's written by this gal who goes into this meditative state, and she's hearing all these voices from Jesus, and she's writing all this stuff down, and I'm going, I have not heard of this. I can't watch and see everything, and I don't have time to really talk about everything. I got a guy that's emailing me today about Jerry Boykin, who is hooked up with Calvary Chapel. Jerry Boykin and, who is it? I can't remember the guy's name. Anyway, there were Knights of Malta, Catholic Knights of Malta, hooked into the Calvary Chapel movement and the Joel's Army movement. And people are falling for this hook, line, and sinker. And it requires watchmen. It requires people who are going to look, who are going to analyze, who are going to say, you know what? I can see from Scripture right now that that's not right. And you test the spirits, and you try them, and you prove all things, and you hold fast that which is good. So my commendation goes to all y'all out there who are diligent, who are watching, and people call you names, and you're a kook, and you're a nut, and there's something wrong with you. But you're watching what's going on. You see the sword coming, and with the help of our ministry and several others, now you can spot it way off in the distance. And you say, Pastor Mike, here's what's coming along. Sound the alarm. And that's what I'm going to do today with this Jesus Calling thing. Several of you, when I made mention Thursday, some of you sent me some information. And I appreciate that. And again, I don't remember who all sent me. I remember Dixie did, and I remember a couple. But I don't remember the names. But if you sent it to me, I greatly appreciate it, because that was the springboard for some of the research that I did. And it didn't take me long either to put some things together. I ended up going to the Jesus Calling Facebook page, and when I saw, there was like two postings there, and I'm going to show you what they are in a minute. And as soon as I saw them, I went, there you go, right there. There it is. Because when you learn the language of the New World Order, when you learn the code words, when you understand the newage a little bit and learn how they talk, and God does not talk that way, then you have understanding of what the end game is. So I got a couple articles here. I'm going to rely heavily on them because I cannot memorize this information. It's just, I mean, I'm looking at this stuff today is when I finally had time to do it. One website, a book review of Jesus Calling at chalice.com, whatever that is. The author writes, this is a book about experiencing the presence of God. And they note that this presence is always capitalized in the book. It is about growing closer in relationship to the Lord, something every Christian craves. The author, Sarah Young, uses presence to describe a very tangible feeling of God's presence. Here's some background. The first time she encountered this presence, again, it's always with a capital P. Now, I went looking in the King James Bible, because I'm not ashamed to say that. I went looking in the Word of God, and there are several references to God and His presence, one of which was the fact that God banished Adam and Eve from His presence. God cast them out. But you never find, you'll find King of Kings, Lord of Lords capitalized. You'll find Jehovah capitalized. You'll find Lord capitalized. You'll find Christ and Jesus capitalized. You'll find Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. You will not see God referred to in the proper noun as the presence. You will not find that in the scriptures. I mean, so already, it looks like we're veering just a little bit off course, but I'm not getting all, you know, thrown out of course on this one here or whatever, but I'm reading what she is saying in this book. Now, here is her testimony of how all of this got started. Here's a quote from the Jesus Calling book. One night I found myself leaving the warmth of our cozy chalet. Who lives in a chalet? I used to drive a Chevrolet. Does that count? Anyway, our cozy chalet to walk alone in the snowy mountains. I went into a deeply wooded area feeling vulnerable and awed by cold, moonlit beauty. The air was crisp and dry, piercing to inhale. Suddenly, I felt as if a warm mist enveloped me. See? You read some of the stuff in the newage, you read some of this, and that's what you hear. I became aware of a lovely presence, capital P. Now, what she's telling you is that she had an encounter with a spirit. It wasn't a flesh and blood contact. She has an encounter with a spirit. That's who she describes as the presence, capital P. And my involuntary response was to whisper, "Sweet Jesus." Involuntary response. Something's wrong with that. This utterance was totally uncharacteristic of me, and I was shocked to hear myself speaking so tenderly to Jesus. As I pondered this brief communication, I realized it was the response of a converted heart. At that moment, I knew I belonged to Him. Now, stop right here. That is very similar to what I remember Joyce Meyer describing her conversion experience. Joyce Meyer used to be into astrology. She used to be in some of the occult arts. This is according to a St. Louis Post-Dispatch news article that came out on her somewhere around 2004. I've got them somewhere. They're archived on the internet. Type in Post-Dispatch Joyce Meyer. They run several articles, and then they detailed her past because she is a St. Louis celebrity. She lives in this county. Won't pay her real estate taxes. But she lives in this county. We're neighbors, Joyce and I, okay? BFF, not. But anyway, Joyce, if you ask me, Pastor Mike, you remember when you got saved? Yes. I realized I was hearing the preaching of God's word from a missionary, Dennis Teague. He was a missionary to France. He was preaching at the youth camp. And I remember him preaching on hell and the need for salvation. And I remember the word of God. And I asked my mother during the invitation, "Mom," I was 9 years old, "Mom, can I get saved?" She said, "Yes." And I remember going down to the altar. And I remember the sinner's prayer. And I remember asking God to forgive my sins and cleanse my heart and have Jesus come live in my life. That is very similar to what a lot of you went through. It was the foolishness of preaching that God chose, not man. God chose to save people. But her experience is minus the Word of God. It is totally in the absence of the written scriptures, the Word of God. It doesn't exist. What she's telling you is that she was converted to a feeling by a feeling, an emotion. And if you've heard me talk, I do not trust my emotions. I'll be honest with you. I woke up very early this morning, and I had a lot of emotional things on my mind when I went to sleep. It took me forever to go to sleep last night, and then I woke up, and they're there this morning. Then compounding that with being tired from getting up so early and not being able to go back to sleep, and I've come to work, and I'm tired, and I come in, I say hi to everybody. I'm going upstairs. I've not had very little sleep, and everybody goes, going up there, Pastor Mike, because they know that if I'm not feeling my jolly self, I want to get away from people. Not because I hate everybody, but because I want to be careful about how I treat people. So I just get away from them so I'm not hateful to anybody, especially my wife. And so I've just loaded with emotions this morning that I don't trust. And devils will work on those emotions. They will play on them. That's your weaknesses. I don't trust them. I don't, you tell me, oh, I had this experience, and the stuff went up on my neck, and I felt this thing, and oh, it was good, and I think I'm a Christian now. I don't trust that at all. Not for a second. Tell me the scriptures that led you to admitting that you were a sorry, low-down, scumbag made out of dirt, mud, sinner that led you to repentance. Tell me about that. But this is her conversion experience, just like Joyce Meyer. Joyce Meyer said that she saw Jesus, saw a vision, and Jesus said, I'm going to call you to the ministry, and that was it right there. So anyway, I realized it was the response of a converted heart. At that moment, I knew I belonged to him. This was far more than the intellect, and listen to how she talks. This is far more than the intellectual answers for which I had been searching. This was a relationship with the creator of the universe. Now, you need to understand what she's saying here. Because, and I've done this before, go watch, not now, let me finish. Go watch the Mystery of Contemplative Prayer. Because in that, I explain in there the two parts of our brain. This part over here on the left side actually controls the right hand. And think about the symbolism of the right hand in the scriptures. Where's the book? It's at the right hand. Where's Christ? At the right hand. But it's the left side of your brain. The left side of your brain is intellect. It is logic. It is yes or no, white or black. The switch is on or the switch is off. It's all very simple. It's binary code. Zeros and ones is what it is. It's guys in cubicles going through pieces of information, trying to piece them together and looking for answers and things like that. That is your intellect, and that is how the Word of God is written. It is written on paper, white paper, black ink, with these characters that our intellect can put together into words, and the words form sentences, and we comprehend them on a conscious level. We understand the meaning, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. It is your intellect that gives you understanding of that to realize that is how God saves people. It is through his Son and his sacrifice. It is God's gift to us. It's your intellect that brings you to salvation. That is, if you want to look at it this way, that is the masculine part. Because men, and I'm not knocking women, but men tend to think more logical. Men don't decorate bathrooms. We don't. To us, it's nonsense to decorate a bathroom. But my wife loves to decorate the bathroom. And I help her, and she'll say, no, move that over just now. Hang on, let me look. Okay, bring it down. Okay, why this picture here? It's just right. And she's good at it. And when I get done, I look at it and go, you know, it does look pretty. I mean, I got some of that in me. And the male, the man, the intellect is always supposed to be in charge. This is what I was preaching Sunday about the roles of a husband and a wife. The creative part of our brain controls the left side, and it draws pictures and writes music and appreciates songs and lyrics and poetry and sees fuzzy little animals in the clouds and all of that stuff. It makes it, it helps us draw a picture when we're reading the Word of God. It is a help to us. But it's never supposed to be in charge, ever. What happens when people take drugs like LSD? This part takes over. This is why they jump off buildings and, man, I can fly. They already are. It's not supposed to be in charge. And listen to what she's saying. She says, this was far more than the intellectual answers for which I had been searching. In other words, she was not satisfied with the written Word of God. And she actually says it in here. This was a relationship with the Creator of the universe. She is establishing the idea that the God that she is following is more than just words on a paper. He is a felt presence, feelings, emotions, intuition, things like that. Sue from Georgia sent me some CDs. She used to be a Nazarene. The Nazarenes have been taken over almost completely with contemplative prayer. They had a guy speaker at one of these Nazarene churches, Tim something another, and he's praying. He's going to teach. He's speaking, you know, this like modern language. We're going to understand God in our modernity. You know, they talk like this. Like they're from California, dude. This sounding rational. And so he's talking about, he's praying, and he's saying, God, help us to intuit you. Deepen our presence. Help us to intuit you. What he was saying was, we want something that's more than the Bible. We want feelings, God. We want them to overrule everything else. That's why the serpent went to Eve. He was playing against the rational ideas given by God, the Father, to Adam, the Son. That's why he went to Eve. So, the article goes on. She grew in her love for God and grew in her desire to spend time with him, speaking to him in prayer and hearing from him through the word. It was in 1992 that she received a copy of God Calling, a book, which she describes as, quote, a devotional book written by two anonymous listeners. She has that in quotation marks, listeners. These women practice waiting quietly in God's presence, pencils and paper in hand, recording the messages they received from him. The messages are written in the first person with I designating God. This book became a treasure and a textbook. So here's the thing. She's been converted now by this feeling, by this spirit. She then gets a hold of a copy of a book called God Calling. I'd like to look into that a little bit. I haven't had time. But it's written by these two listeners, these ladies, women, silly women, being led captors, being led. Let me look up that verse. Let me look up the word. I can find it real quick. Silly. Yeah. For this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women, laden with sins, led away with divers lusts, feelings, emotions. So here's this woman. Rather than receiving instruction and training from the written Word of God and her husband, she's now reading two other women who do automatic writing. This is what Mark Verkler was promoting on Sid Roth's It's Supernatural. He was talking about going into this contemplative prayer state, shutting your brain down, getting in contact with this God on the inside of you, and as God delivers these messages to you, you write them down, because that's God's message for you. That's God talking to you. It is over and above the Word of God. So anyway, here's what Sarah Young continues to say. The following year, I began to wonder if I too could receive messages during my times of communing with God. There we go right there. That's what this is about. It is about how she got turned over to a reprobate mind by abandoning the authority and the final authority of the Word of God and receiving message, new messages from God, new prophecies, new things from God that no one else had. I wonder if God would do this for me. And this book is all about turning mainstream Christianity into little gods and goddesses that intuit the words of God that are far better than the intellectual words that are in your Bible. So she said, I had been writing in prayer journals for years, but that was one-way communication. I did all the talking. I knew that God communicated with me through the Bible, but I yearned for more. Did you catch that? I know that God's got the Bible, I believe in the verbal inspiration of God in the original manuscripts. That's what she's saying. I believe that God spoke through the Bible, but I wanted more than that. And she neglects the very clear warning at the end of the book of Revelation, where Jesus said, there is no more. This is it right here. And if you know what it is? This is like the Israelites in the wilderness loathing the manna from heaven. They're looking at that manna saying, if I have to eat that garbage one more time, and they complain in the wilderness. And I love the King James Bible. God said, I'm going to give you so much quail, it's going to come out of your nose. That would have been funny. And I think that literally happened. I think they ate so much of that quail, it made them sick to their stomach, and they puked out their nose. That's what I think happened. You didn't really want me to say that at lunchtime, did you? But she said, I know that God communicated with me through the Bible, but I yearned for more. I want something else. Yeah, Pastor Mike, that Bible's, that's fine. I want more than that. Be careful, people. Increasingly, I wanted to hear what God had to say to me personally on a given day. Well, that comes from the scriptures, people. I decided to listen to God with pen in hand, writing down whatever I believe he was saying. I felt awkward the first time I tried this, but I received a message. It was short, biblical, and appropriate. She said it was biblical. You know why she said that? She wants these readers to accept what she's saying as this is from God. So she's going to attach just enough scripture to it to hook everybody in. This is like the lame excuse I used to hear from teenagers who when you say, you know, boy, you shouldn't listen to that music. They're a Christian. Justin Bieber's a Christian. They pray before other concerts. Him as mommy, they pray. They pray to God before other concerts. He's a Christian. Really? So they're going to hook just enough scripture into it. And I haven't seen the King James Version yet. To make it valid for the people, they say, okay, yeah, I got the Bible, but, oh, I'm getting something from God. It's no different when Pat Robertson fakes it at the end of the 700 Club. Oh, God's talking to me right now. I see a woman. There's a woman in Tulsa, Oklahoma right now who's having back pains. Duh! Half the women in Tulsa have back pains, Pat. Anyway, so I decided to listen to God with pen in hand. It addressed topics that were current in my life, trust, fear, and closeness to God. I responded by writing in my prayer journal. The article goes on to say, at one point she says, I knew these writings were not inspired as scripture is, but they were helping me grow closer to God. See, she's talking out, she says, I know that these aren't inspired like the Bible is, but they work better. That's what she said. The Bible is, of course, the only inerrant word of God. My writings must be consistent with that unchanging standard, and I'm going to show you that they're not. She's lying through her teeth. She then says, how does she get this stuff? I have continued to receive personal messages from God as I meditate on him. The more difficult my life circumstances, the more I need these encouraging directives from my Creator. So she gets this stuff by meditation. She then says, I softly announce my presence. Or excuse me, this is one of the things that the presence told her. Now remember, she is in contact with a spirit that seems awfully familiar. And that's what it is. It's a familiar spirit. So here is what the presence said to her. Softly I announce my presence. Shimmering hues of radiance tap gently at your consciousness, seeking entrance. Hey, pass that around, man. That's good stuff. That's what that sounds like. It sounds like a bunch of newagers on weed in California saying, hey, man, what do you see? Man, I see shimmering hues of radiance tapping gently at my consciousness, seeking entrance. The presence goes on to say, though I have all power in heaven and earth, I am infinitely tender with you. The weaker you are, the more gently I approach you. Let your weakness be a door to my presence. Whenever you feel inadequate, here, see the word feeling? Whenever you feel inadequate, remember that I am your ever-present help. Let's see here. The article says that it is equally notable that many of Jesus' words sound very little like what he says in the Bible. For example, let the light of my presence soak into you as you focus your thoughts on me. And shortly after, learn to hide in the secret of my presence. That's your first clue, Sherlock. The secret of my presence. There is no secret of the presence of God. The mystery has been revealed plainly in the scriptures. Anytime you run into a secret doctrine or a secret spirit, a secret idea, or the, as she put it, learn to hide in the secret of my presence, you're dealing with mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots, the female, the woman. Even as you carry out your duties in the world. Let's see here. I have two articles here, and I underline a bunch of stuff. Let me get to the second article here. This one is CICministry.org, Toxic Devotion, a review of Sarah Young's Jesus Calling by Bob DeWay. This particular writer of the article, equates Sarah Young's version of what she's hearing from this spirit to Eckhart Tolle, the guy that Brian McLaren and Rob Bell and all these other kooks are following, these new age people. Who is the guy that's hooked up with Rick Warren? Wrote Soul Tsunami and Quantum Spirituality. But anyway, these are the guy. This is the guy they follow. He is a newager. And he says, let us explore the most prominent category found in both Jesus' calling and a new earth. Eckhart Tolle writes, awareness is the power that is concealed within the present moment. That is why we may also call it a presence, capital P. We shall see that Young's Jesus also speaks of the present moment as being key. Tolle continued, this is Eckhart Tolle. Only presence can free you of the ego, and you can only be present now, not yesterday or tomorrow. Only presence can undo the past in you and thus transform your state of consciousness. And what he's saying here, what Eckhart Tolle is saying, is that it's not the blood, it's not the sacrificial atonement, it's not the crucified death of Jesus on the cross, him preaching his spirits in prison, rising again the third day, ascending to the Father and acting as an intermediary between you and God or me and God. It's none of that. It is this feeling that that can do away and undo your past. All the mistakes you made, well, then all you need then is a spiritual experience like an awakening. And the cross has nothing to do with it. So here's what Sarah Young in her book refers to that awareness and that presence. You need to look beyond the flux of, now this is apparent, this is her, not her talking. This is what the presence told her. This is word for word what her spirit guide, who she's trying to pass on as Jesus. Remember, there's two of them. the real Jesus, who has already spoken to us in these last days, in the Word of God, the written scripture Word of God, and another Jesus who is violating his own covenant by adding words beyond the book of Revelation. So which Jesus are you going to follow? And I'm going to strongly encourage you. I don't know how much of this. I'm going to give this a thorough talking. I may not get done today. I may continue this Thursday. If I do, we're going to provide the links. And I strongly encourage you to pass this along to people. And I'll tell you why. I was gobsmacked. I started looking on different, you know, just typed it in, Sarah Young, Jesus Calling, and so on. You just find it all over the place. FamilyChristian.com. It's a Christian bookstore, online Christian bookstore. They give it a 5-star rating. They're selling the book. It is a best seller. You can get it with a brown leather flex soft color cover if you want. There is the customer reviews. I received this book as a gift in 2012. Little did I know that it would rock my world. Her writings are so helpful and true. It's almost as if Jesus was using her pen to write directly to me at my station in life. Highly recommend this. That's what you get. And here's the problem with that. The Bible tells us how God speaks to mankind. Holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Holy men of God. There is no female writer in the scripture. Not one. And so this right here is in contradiction and contrary to the very words of God that people are supposed to follow. So what they're doing en masse is that they are following a different Jesus and a different gospel led by another spirit called the presence. Jesus said, "Lo, if any man say unto you, here is Christ or there, believe it not." Don't fall for it. Don't be deceived. And this stuff is deception, pure and simple. One person wrote, "I purchased 5 copies of this last Christmas when they were one of the special deals of the day. I gave copies to my sister-in-law's, pastor's wife, my daughter-in-law's mom. I'm so glad I kept a copy for myself. Given to me as a gift, I'm now reading it and journaling as I hear God speak." See, it worked. Now other people are abandoning the scriptures in exchange for new revelations, new words from God. Now I'm right. Just like Mark Verkler told everybody on Sid Ross, "It's supernatural." Write down what you hear. The problem is we are under contract. Just like, let's say that you work for IBM and you were one of their top engineers. And while working, and you're under contract, while working, you signed it. IBM said, "We're going to pay you $125,000 a year. We're going to buy you a car. We're going to put you up in a house. We're going to give you health care. We're going to give you a 401k. We're going to do everything. We're going to treat you pretty good because you're a pretty smart guy." The thing is, if you invent anything, even in your basement, while you work for us and are under contract, we own it. That's ours. And so there have been lawsuits over intellectual property because people were under contract with some company, software company, hardware company, or whatever. They invented something on the side, and their company said, "That's ours, Jack. We own it." It's contract law, pure and simple. And you and I, as part of our inheritance, our salvation, we are under contract. And that contract is that we will believe everything that God said. And God stipulated in the contract on the last page. This is it right here. There are no more pages to be added. There are no more verses. There are no more words. And if anybody does, you violate the contract. If you add to it, I'm going to add plagues that are written here for everybody else. If you take away from it, I'm going to take your name out of the book of life. That is a breach of contract. And churches and pastors and people are falling for it left and right. The people that put me onto this, they were telling me, Pastor, my relative, my so-and-so relative is involved in this, fallen for it. And they want me to do it. And it doesn't sound right to me. Will you look into this? Absolutely I will, because it's deadly dangerous. And you are going, I promise you, as you stick your neck out on this thing and try to warn people, they will mock you, laugh at you. They will think you're in some strange cult. Your mind's twisted by Mike Hoggard. You need to get away from that guy. That's what they're going to tell you. But you know me. When I get done reading what's wrong with this book, we're going to go to Scripture. And we already have already. Her Facebook page. You can, if you're on Facebook right now, it's facebook.com Jesus Calling is what it is. And you better not like it. I'm just saying, you better not like it. She's got people that are just slobbering all over themselves on these posts on that. And by the way, now there is a version of this called Jesus Calling for Children. Now it's teaching a whole generation of children to abandon the written record of the Word of God, which their pastor did long time ago anyway, in exchange for these new revelations. Now these kids are going to be writing down out of the abundance of their very wicked, foolish heart and saying, but Mommy, that's from God. God told me that. Some of the comments on the Facebook page. Awesome devotion speaks directly to your heart. A very sweet pastor of ours gave us a Jesus Calling book. A pastor. Shame on him. This is one of my favorite devotionals. Let's see here. This is now just, there is a posting on here that says, when you lean on me, you are truly strong. And that's from Jesus. That's from the presence. One person writes, this is now, just now, my scripture to start following immediately. Breach of contract. This person's name is Chris, you just broke your contract with God, the new covenant, the New Testament. You went after another word, but not the Bible. I am going to write it down on the index card and put it where I can see it every day. I needed to see this right now today. Thank you. Praise the Lord. This is my go-to, and another person writes, this is my go-to scripture for the hard days. It's catching on. It is taking over. And that's only because the pastors of these people created the void. And nature abhors a void. It's just like what I've been teaching. You plow up a piece of land and root up all those weeds. If you don't go out there and plant something, nature's going to do it herself. And what has happened in churches all over the world is that pastors created a void of the written authority of the word, of the final authority of the written word of God. They created that void. And now she is taking over and moving in. So it all goes back to the pastors. Here is one of the comments. Here's another passage by The Presence. You need to look beyond the flux of circumstances. That just, see, Jesus said, you know, my sheep know my voice. And I just never heard Jesus say flux. Never did. Those of you who are Trekkies in Star Trek The Next Generation, you remember Data, Lieutenant Data, had a twin brother, Lore. He was actually his predecessor. The guy built Lore, put emotions in him, and then he built Data, took the emotions away. And here's how they figured out the first time that Lore showed up and was acting like Data. Because Data was programmed, he never used verbal contractions. He never said can't, don't, ain't. He never said that. He always says cannot, I do not do that. And Lore slipped up and said, nope, can't do that. And they went, you're not Data. You're his evil twin. That's who you are. How did they recognize him? By what came out of his mouth. This word, flux, never came out of my Savior's mouth in the scriptures. Never. You need to look beyond the flux of circumstances and discover me gazing lovingly back at you. You know what that sounds like? That sounds like when you were like in seventh grade, gals, and you had your eyes on this pretty boy at school, and you kept looking at him. You were just hoping that he would look back. That, you remember the gaze? Remember that? This awareness of my presence strengthens you as you receive and respond to my love. Listen to this one. This is what got me going. Been teaching on the fourth kingdom. I'm going to record part four tomorrow. I'm going to be dealing with principalities this weekend. Here is what the presence said. Now listen to this language of the fourth kingdom. Listen to it. Let me infuse my presence into your thoughts. As your mind stops racing, your body relaxes and you regain awareness of me. Now, what this is a subtle teaching of going into a meditative state. Your mind is racing right now because you are conscious and you are sober and your intellect is processing everything. And we talked about this last week. Remember, the devil comes in sideways. He doesn't come in straight on while you're thinking about him. And so this is what this is teaching. He's telling you, the presence is telling you, slow your brain way down, go into an alpha state, because that unlocks the window so we can get in. As your mind stops racing, your body relaxes and you regain awareness of me. There are actually more than four dimensions in this world where you live. In addition to the three dimensions of space and the one of time, there is the dimension of openness to my presence. This is a portal. It is a doorway to another dimension. And that doorway right now is locked. And the presence here does not have the key. You do. That's what they're teaching you. You're the only one who can unlock this door. And I strongly encourage you, don't do it. I don't recommend hypnosis. Not even by a secular doctor. I don't recommend it. Meditative prayer, contemplative prayer, the Jesus prayer, Ignatius, that stuff opens a door that they cannot open. You have to open it. And once you do, you're the fool, because you're going to let them in. Here's another one from the presence. I am God with you for all time and throughout eternity. Do not let the familiarity of that concept numb its impact on your consciousness. Strive to remain conscious of my presence even in your busiest moments. Work. Strive. Keep doing. Keep performing. No wonder you don't feel me. You're busy working or reading the Bible or something. Listen to this one. This is what Jude was talking about, turning the grace of God into lasciviousness. Here's what the presence said. If I was this gal's husband, I would be insanely jealous of this presence, because it would be obvious to me that Sarah Young is getting way more from this spirit than she ever does her husband. This is what the presence says. For years you swam around in a sea of meaninglessness, searching for love, hoping for hope. All that time I was pursuing you aching to embrace you in my compassionate arms. I sang you a love song whose beginning and end are veiled in eternity. Remember the veil, the mystery? It's a secret. And it sounds to me exactly what the sons of God said to the daughters of men in Genesis 6. Hey, baby, I've been looking for you for a long time. My heart, here's Jesus. Now, you're supposed to think this is Jesus. And it sounds like he's making $1,915 a second phone call to this lady, talking erotic to her. I was pursuing you, aching to embrace you in my compassionate arms. I used to write that kind of junk when I was a young teenager. Maybe I still should every now and then to my wife. That is turning the grace, and you guys have seen this. You guys have spotted this before in your church or at the meetings or at the big conferences where it's the Jesus is my boyfriend who wants me concept. That's the salvation that they have. And these preachers are constantly talking about intimacy with God. Oh, I have such this intimate relationship with God. That's not in the Bible. That's not how the shepherd speaks. You never hear the shepherd telling the sheep, I want to be intimate with you. And then here's another one. The more intimately you experience me, the more convinced you become of my goodness. I am the living one, capital O-N-E, the living one who sees you and longs to participate in your life. These words and descriptions such as longing and aching and pursuing and all of this garbage is not the voice of the shepherd. It's not. And here's another one. Never take for granted my intimate nearness. Marvel at the wonder of my continual presence with you. Even the most ardent human lover cannot be with you always. You see, there it is right there. If I was this gal's husband, I would be insanely jealous of this spirit that she is making love to in her feelings and in her thoughts and in her mind. And the spirit told her, baby, I can do things for you that your husband can't do. Listen to what it says again. Even the most ardent human lover cannot be with you always. Nor can another person know the intimacies of your heart, mind, and spirit. I, the lover, capital L, the lover of your soul, understand you perfectly and love you eternally. That is the grace of God turned into lasciviousness. Get your King James Pure Bible Search software and type in the word whisper. You're going to come up with Psalm 41:7. All that hate me whispered together against me. That's what a conspiracy is. A conspiracy has breath in it. And you're whispering because you don't want everybody to find out what it is. And then in Isaiah 29:4, and thou shalt be brought down and shall speak out of the ground, and thy speech shall be low out of the dust, and thy voice shall be as of one that hath a familiar spirit out of the ground, and thy speech shall whisper out of the dust. And this is what we hear. We hear from Beth Moore et al. And telling us, you need to do whisper prayers. You need to talk to God in whispers, because that's how God talks back. He talks in whispers. And they call it the still small voice. That's not it. The whisper is not a still small voice. A whisper is without voice. A still small voice is a very low, very quiet voice. And this is how God, Mike, this is how God talks. When he speaks to our spirit and directs us to the Word of God, this is how he does it. But here's why I say this. The article says, one request that Young attributes to Jesus a number of times is, whisper my name. This contributes to the sense of romantic intimacy she portrays. For example, and here is what the whisperer said to her, the presence. When you are with other people, you often lose sight of my presence. When you realize this has happened, whisper my name. This tiny act of trust brings me to the forefront of your consciousness where I belong. This is a familiar spirit who must be summoned. He must be. That's what the Jesus prayer is all about. You go into this state, you'd light candles, turn on this soft music with no real melody to it, and you start whispering Jesus over and over and over again. And if I remember right, that's what she did. She said the first time she felt the presence, she involuntarily said, where is it? Sweet Jesus, in a whisper. That's how she got it. And now listen to what she says. This is, remember, the presence. Do you remember, before I read this, do you remember I dealt with this and I talked about a guy by the name of Neil Donald Walsh who wrote Conversations with God because he was hearing from God and God was talking to him and God was telling him, here's the thing, Neil. Everybody says, oh, you got to read the book. Well, let me tell you, I speak in words way beyond what books can write down. And what he was telling Neil to tell the world is, don't read the Bible. That's not me. That binds me, and I don't like it. I want to tell you something. When the Word of God is written, when the Word of God is read, and it binds something, that's not God. That's a spirit that is bound and cannot handle the Word of God. Listen to what the presence said. As you spend time in my presence, my thoughts gradually form in your mind. My thoughts gradually form in your mind. Do you remember? I'm going to go back and watch this movie again. Do you remember Leonardo DiCaprio? A movie called Inception. If I remember right, and I'm going to go back and watch it again to get my bearings, because I think I might include it in this Fourth Kingdom thing. There was Leonardo DiCaprio had this ability through all this technology to get into people's dreams and interact with them. And he was actually hired by this guy to go down into this guy's subconscious, going four levels down into this guy's dream state to plant a thought in his mind without him being aware of it. That is perception without awareness. Plant a thought in his mind because this Japanese dude wanted this other guy to sell him his company and he wouldn't do it. So he hires DiCaprio to go into this guy's fourth level of his dream state, of his sleep state. Plant a thought in there so that when he wakes up, he gets on the phone and says, hey, I'm going to sell my company to Hiroshaki or whatever the guy's name was. That's what this is saying. He says, when you realize this has happened, whisper my name. This tiny act of trust brings me to the forefront of your consciousness where I belong. And then it says, as you spend time in my presence, my thoughts gradually form in your mind like a baby. Lust bringeth forth sin. Sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Lust, when it is conceived, bringeth forth sin. Sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. So the presence says, sometimes he enables you to hear me speak directly to you. And he's in this case, the presence is referring to what he calls the Holy Spirit. Take time to listen to my voice. Here's another one. I have much to tell you. You are walking along the path I have chosen for you. It is both a privileged and a perilous way. Experience my glorious presence and heralding that reality to others. There it is right there. These spirits that are working these people, They want to use human agents, just like Christ is using his disciples to preach the gospel. This familiar spirit is beckoning Sarah Young to write this down, sell it, make $1 million off of it, so she can con everybody else into doing exact same thing. And I'll tell you, she writes this as if this presence, when it gets around her, is like the most wonderful, fantastic, awesome feeling that it's like a high. It's like taking some sort of drug for the first time and going, oh, that's good. I remember the first time they gave me morphine on a drip in the hospital. The nurse said, now, are you allergic to morphine? I said, I don't know, never had it before. She said, well, we're going to watch you. So she injected me with this morphine, and I'm laying there, and I'm going. And she says, are you okay? And I'm going, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I'm fine. That's what this is. She is selling heroin, spiritual heroin, through this book, saying, you need this, man. And people are turning into it. Now, here's the thing. I got a book I read several years ago. I've been rereading it slowly but surely. Written by a guy who used to be in the New Age. Randall Bear is his name. And he said when he first got conned into talking with familiar spirits, it was the most awesome, blessed, blissful, euphoric, and there's other words that he used, feeling that he had ever experienced in his life, and he was hooked. And he said the farther down the road he went, the darker it got. And when he tried to pull back away from going into these meditations and experiencing these familiar spirits, because they were really starting to show their face, when he refused to meditate, they came over him with a vengeance. That's what's going to happen here. It all starts out feeling like this, a massive heroin or Vicodin or morphine rush. It always turns bad, and it's going to. Let's see if I can see any more here. When my presence is the focal point of your consciousness, all the pieces of your life fall into place. In other words, when you experience me, then everything's right. Again, nothing about the cross here. Nothing about the substitutionary atonement of Christ. Nothing about coming to the cross. Nothing about the law bringing you under condemnation, so that you'll come to Christ. Nothing about that. It's all about, say the magic words and I'll show up. And then here's how she describes she does it. The presence tells her, I meet you in the stillness of your soul, which is meditative prayer, contemplative prayer. It is there that I seek to commune with you. Stillness of soul is increasingly rare in this world addicted to speed and noise. Now, remember, this is supposed to be Jesus talking, and that's not him. I am pleased with your desire to create a quiet space where you and I can meet. A quiet space. In other words, if you don't go into meditation and contemplation and emptying your mind, if you don't do that, I can't show up. That is a limited God. It's not the real one. It's not the real Jesus. The present says, teaching you would be simple if I negated your free will or overwhelmed you with my power. However, I love you too much to withdraw the God-like privilege I bestowed on you as my image bearer. Let's break that one down for a second. I love you too much to withdraw the God-like privilege. Did you catch that? Now, Sarah Young, you're like a god now. That's what you are. And then he said, I bestowed on you as my image bearer, my light bearer, Lucifer, making all of these little, let's open up our can of King James here, because I think it is warranted. Let's read 2 Corinthians 11. Let's see. And you know, here's what I was thinking about before the broadcast today in relation to this. For years, the denominations kind of bickered back and forth, because one denomination saw this and one denomination saw that in the scripture, and one denomination said, oh no, it's predestination. Another one said, no, it's free will. And another one said, no, it's tongues. And another one said, no, we follow John Wesley. No, we follow John Calvin. No, we follow this. And they were kind of bickering back and forth, getting along at the Sunday picnics and the, you know, the square dances and things like that. But, you know, we don't go to that church because we don't agree with their doctrine. And the thing is, they were all reading the same Bible. They just didn't quite get along as far as believing, or they all believed the Word of God. They just saw through a glass darkly, and they bickered over the Word of God, over the Bible, over the King James Bible. They bickered and argued over the doctrines of the King James Bible. We've gone way past that one. Way past that one. Because now the substantial difference between us and them is that you and I are still bickering over the words that are in the King James Bible. You and I still believe every word in this book, and you see it one way and I see it another, and I love you. I mean, I love you because you believe the King James. And I would never condemn any of you for believing what's in this book. I'd ask you to do the same with me, because I believe every word in this book, every one of them. I may not understand it well enough for you. I may not understand it the way you do. Whatever. But I believe every word in this book. These people out here, uh-uh. They abandon it. Their pastors created the void. And now Satan is all too eager to come in and fill that void with words that are not the Word of God. And so 2 Corinthians 11, this is where Paul warned about another Jesus, another spirit, and another gospel. And this is where he says, verse 13, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers. That's Sarah Young. That's Neil Donald Walsh. That is Brian McLaren. That is all these people who are intuiting God's voice and not reading it from the Bible, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. And let me just kind of help some of you who may be, you know, kind of on the, you know, on this, kind of on the fence on this deal about whether or not the King James is accurate in everything it says, because you've been told that in Isaiah 14, the word Lucifer is really not in the original manuscripts, that word was made up, and it really should say bright and morning star. That's not what it says. The King James translators knew the whole of Scripture. And they use the term Lucifer because it literally means, Lucis means light. The Ofer, like Christopher. Christopher means the bearer of Christ. Lucifer is a messenger of light. That's what it says here, an angel of light. The word angelos means messenger. And so the translators got it right. You have two witnesses now. Isaiah 14, 2 Corinthians 11, 14, that his name is Angel of Light or Lucifer. That's his name. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works, not their faith, their works. So Lucifer is greatly in the process of transforming church people into little Lucifers, bearers of the image of the presence. That's what the presence told Sarah Young. You have this godlike blessing. You're like a god now because you are the image bearer of the presence. It's Satanism. You're worshiping the beast, being led by the false prophet. Come out of that. I've dedicated my life, my ministry, 7 times a week in front of a camera, every week, trying to show you that this Bible is the coolest thing you have ever laid your eyes on. It's the stone that the builders rejected. It's the stone that the pastors threw out. Said, we can't use that to build our new hip-hop church. And they started going to these other Bibles. And now, because there was nothing in there, it's like eating Rice Krispies for breakfast. You eat it, an hour later, you are starving to death. Because that's what they fed you at church. And so now, Sid Roth promoting it. Now churches all over the country, all over the world, promoting it. Number one, to women. I mean, the cover of this book. Let me see if I can pull it up here. The cover of this book is all nice and pretty. It's for women. And then it's for children who have this spiritual void in them, and pastors won't fill it with the Word of God ever. So now they're falling, they're being duped for this stuff, and this presence spirit, this familiar spirit, wants to turn you into a light bearer. That's what they want to do. They want to transform you and your family members and your pastor's wife into these little Lucifers. Oh, pastor, we worship Jesus at our church. Which one? Which, just a legitimate question. Which one? Because there's two of them. And the moment you walked away from the King James Bible, Satan started introducing to you the other Jesus, very subtly. Very snakily introducing to you through another spirit and emotional experiences another Jesus. And this other Jesus was a lovemaker like you've never had before. And he got you. And you're hooked on the heroin of his presence. And if you dare try to leave, they will treat you and persecute you and beat on you so bad because they don't want you to leave. They don't want you to give up. They don't want you to walk away from it. And you come to the conclusion, you know what? This is not in the Bible. I'm not falling for it. I'm going to get my Bible out and read it. They will try to kill you. If God would let them, they would try to kill you. Maybe this is what was going on with me this morning. I don't know. I think the devil is a beast, and I think these beasts can smell a revival. They did it in the days when Moses was born, and they did it in the days when Jesus was born. Here is one of the other statements from the presence. Most of mankind's misery stems from feeling unloved. No. Man's misery is caused by self-love, sin. That's where man's misery. See, that's not Jesus. Jesus did not say that. Because Jesus knows what the cause of misery is. Because he told Adam and Eve what was going to happen now that they broke God's law. They were going to live in the state of misery. Festus misery, actually. And here's one more. I knew that God communicated with me through the Bible, but I yearned for more. Increasingly, I wanted to hear what God has to say to me personally on a given day. I yearned for more. So, this woman said, the Bible is not good enough for me. It's like the pastor or the youth pastor or the conference speaker who says and justifies the stories that he tells, the quotations he makes from Gandhi, Ronald Reagan, Napoleon. And it basically says that you can't really understand the Bible. So we're gonna kind of lay it aside, and we're going to give you a feeling. First of all, we're going to turn the music up and get you to bouncing around and swaying and feeling music. Then we're going to inject this message into your subconscious, and you're going to start feeling a presence that you've never felt before, not even when you got saved. That's what we're going to do. And folks, I'm telling you, if anybody ever made you feel bad because you decided, I can't find a church anywhere to go to, and I'm just, you know what, we're just going to watch Bethel. If anybody ever made you feel bad, well, you're not one of us. You're not a Christian because you're forsaking the assembling. No, I'm not. I'm not forsaking the assembling. I assemble with Bethel. Every time they turn the cameras on, I'm there. They made you feel bad, called you names, blocked you, unfriended you on Facebook because get ready. Because when we get done here with this, and I'm already spilling into Thursday with this. We could talk about Syria. I'm kind of waiting to see how that thing plays out. I tweeted over the weekend when Barack Hussein came out and made that statement. I'm going, sorry, Mr. President. You bankrupted this country's confidence in you. And I don't believe a word you say. Not one word. Now, I don't believe some of the other conspiracy theories that are out there. But I don't believe that man when he comes out and says what he says. He's lied too many times. There's all kinds of things to talk about. I think that this is important. Number one, hopefully it will bolster your confidence in sola scriptura, only the word of God, only the written scriptures of the word of God. Hopefully it will embolden you to stand taller, stand firmer on the word of God. Stand for it like you've never stood before. And you guys, some of you know me, know my testimony. There was a time when I might have fallen for this because I was looking for those experiences. I was Sarah Young because I had been brought up in church, trained in Sunday school, taught systematic theology in Bible college. But I wanted more. And I was going to build a house of my life and my career and reject the cornerstone of the King James Bible. That's what I was going to do. And God chastened me. And I mean, God tore me up. the story has not been told of what God did to me those many years ago. But I'm telling you, he got my attention and then very lovingly directed me into the pages of the King James Bible. And every time I prayed, I still say, God, I want dreams and visions. Oh, yeah, I want dreams. And God say, hey, guess what? The prophets all had dreams and visions. Here they are right here. Why don't you read those? And I went, God, you know what? You're right. I haven't even read some of these. You know what I wanted? I wanted God to cheat with me and just give me the answers without reading the book. That's what I wanted. And God knew it. But get ready, because after this broadcast, we're going to do the rendering. We're going to post it on Sermon Audio. We're going to get it out there. Jazz is going to take it, put it on wherever she puts it. I didn't keep up with half of where we are right now. And I want you to find it. I want you to put it on your Facebook page. I want you to tweet it. I want you to email it to people. I want you to send it to them. Not for my popularity, but people need to be told the truth. The trumpet is going to be sounded. Let me kind of give you where I'm going to go Thursday with this. I'm going to continue on with this. Between now and Thursday, if you want to send me any more relevant information on Jesus calling or God calling or anything related to that, I mean, I'll look at it and try to use it just to try to, you know, blend it back in with, and so we can take off with it. But this Thursday, I'm going to give you the scripture side of it. I'm going to show you what's happened. The first thing I want you to do is I want you to turn to Mark 4, or you can just listen as I read it. I'm going to show you how the devil works and what he's done. Mark chapter 4, this of course is the famous parable of the seed and the sower. And if you're one of these that says, well, I don't get my doctrine from parables, you know what? That's just too bad, because you're missing out on some good stuff in the Word of God. Jesus is essentially telling you, this is how I speak. This is the symbols that I use. This is how I explain the symbols. It's all in the Word of God. Had Jesus simply told us this story of the seed and the sower and left it at that, then maybe we would have an excuse to say, you know what? I think God is telling me that the seed is pizza, and some people just don't like pizza, but I like pizza and I'm a good guy. You know, people would come up with all kinds of stupid stuff, but he didn't. He didn't leave it up to us. He said, let me just tell you what it is. The seed is not pizza. It's the Word of God. It's the Word. And so he says, and it came to pass as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and the fowls of the air came and devoured it up. Think of what fowls represent. So what do birds represent in the Bible, Mike? Well, they have wings and they fly. Angels, spirits. But in this case, it's one spirit in particular. And Jesus, in describing and giving you the only proper definition of these symbols, Mark chapter 4, verse 15, these are they by the wayside where the word is sown. But when they have heard, Satan cometh immediately and taketh away the word that was sown in their hearts. Because 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, you had people sitting in churches and they were still hearing the word of God. And what happened was Satan came immediately and devoured the word of God. So it can't take root. It can't germinate. It can't produce anything. It's as if it was never there. You know, you look out, we used to call them snowbirds. I don't know what they were really, but when I was a boy, we could always tell in the wintertime, hey, I think it's going to snow. You know why? Because all those birds were out in the yard. There'd be whole flocks of birds out in the yard picking seeds. They knew. They knew we were fixing to get it. So they were stocking up. They were fattening up. And so that's what birds do. That's what Satan does. in Bible colleges, Bible colleges, Satan began devouring the Word of God years ago. Jack Chick wrote a comic on this called Sabotage. When I read it, when I first read it, entering into Bible college, I did not believe that story of a Bible college kid going in there and then hearing that the Bible really wasn't the Word of God, and it turned him into this monster. I didn't believe that until it happened to me. They told me my Bible had mistakes in it. They told me it was wrong. They told me it really wasn't the Word of God. And it turned Mike Hoggard into this monster. Oh, I repent of those days. But that's the image that, if you want to get a copy of that, I encourage you to do it. Sabotage is one of those full-length comics by Jack Chick. Outstanding. But the devil went into Bible colleges and stole the Bible out. So much so that there was a Bible college in southern Missouri that had Kent Hovind come and do a deal on creation. They threw him out and said, he's never coming back here. In a Bible college, they did that. And then these guys turn out in the churches. Now the churches are going to have the Word of God taken away from them. Christian music had it taken away years ago. The Sunday school literature publishing companies, no Word of God anymore. Satan took the Bible out. Now it's going to grow in its place. What does happen? What does happen when you go out and, you know, plow up ground or whatever as if you're going to sow something and then you don't? What happens? Thorns and briars. That's what happens. I'm going to show you this, and I'm going to continue with this this coming Thursday. This is one of the quotes of the presence. This was on the Facebook page. This is what really got me. This is the presence now saying this. Nothing is wasted when it is shared with me. I can bring beauty out of the ashes. Here we go. Did you see that? That's the phoenix. That's the beast rising up out of the pit. I can bring beauty out of the ashes of lost dreams. I can glean joy out of sorrow, peace out of adversity. Only a friend who is also the King of Kings could accomplish this divine alchemy. Do you know what that is? Alchemy is... rats. Alchemy is the great secret. Alchemy is... they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men so that men can become gods. That's what alchemy is. I guarantee you the Jesus that wrote my Bible did not say that. I guarantee you he did not say that. Alchemy is witchcraft in another form. You don't believe that? Go read the first Harry Potter book. It's there. We're going to continue this Thursday. As soon as I get this done, I'm going to post it. Repost it. Warn people. You might lose friends, but in my experience, we have gained people who write to us all the time and say, we were headed down a road until you came, Pastor Mike, and showed us the truth from the King James Bible. Thank you. I don't know how many people have been turned away from these false things because of what God laid in my heart years ago. But I just decided I wasn't going to hide in a closet anymore with it. I was going to share it. We're watchmen. Won't you do the same? Stand with me, all right? We'll see you Thursday.